Hey guys, welcome to our first at-home video episode of D23 Inside Disney. I'm Candice from Radio Disney.
I'm Sheri from Oh My Disney.
And I'm Jeffrey from D23. And today, in honor of Disney Plus's Throwback Week, we're celebrating some Disney classics with some very special Disney guests.
First up is a man with more than a dozen movies on Disney Plus, like The Lion King, Beauty and the Beast, Hunchback of Notre Dame, Maleficent, maybe you've heard of them. He is a producer, a writer, a director, and he pretty much made my childhood complete. It's Don Hahn.
Hi, I'm Don Hahn, and boy, is it great to be here today. We're going to talk about a lot of fun things about Disney.
Well, this woman is a legend, and more than that, she's a Disney legend. This Broadway star created the role of Belle in Beauty and the Beast, and she reprised it in several beloved sequels. She's also a celebrated painter who has created beautiful pieces for Disney fine art. Welcome, Paige O'Hara.
Hi, everybody. It's Paige. Thanks for having me. It's great to see you.
So, Don and Paige, I've got to jump right in. Beauty and the Beast defined my childhood. According to my parents, I watched it every single day for an embarrassingly large chunk of my childhood. And I couldn't quite pronounce it right. I pronounced it Bean Beast. So, three-year-old Sheri wants to know, what was it like to make Bean Beast?
It was great. It was kind of an honor. I was the first guy on it, and I got this call saying, you know, Walt Disney tried Beauty and the Beast, and he really couldn't figure it out. So we'd like to have you give it a try. And, you know, there's no pressure. So that was the beginning of it. Luckily, we had amazing story crew. We had people like Linda Walton, who eventually wrote Alice in Wonderland for Disney, and Maleficent. Kirk Wise and Gary Trouse, the great directors. And our secret weapon in many, many ways was Howard Ashman and Alan Menken, the songwriters, because at the time they had just come off of Little Mermaid. And we thought, man, these guys understand storytelling with music. So that was kind of our beginnings. And it was a long process. It was, maybe a few days of your life. It was about 4 years of my life. We had a really lucky day in New York when we were doing auditions, when a beautiful young ingenue from the stage walked in the form of Paige O'Hara. And she was Belle. I mean, I wish I could say it differently, but there was this thing about Paige that was a little bit Judy Garland, a little bit, you know, kind of this wonderful, sincere, earnest, interesting actress who luckily could sing, who ended up being our Belle. So it was a series of hard work and great events like that.
Oh, my gosh. Well, for me, it was, like I said, I could take 2 hours just on that one as well, but it was a life-changing experience, you know, and being a Broadway actress, I'd been on Broadway since my teenage years, and this was totally different than anything I'd ever done before. And I was so ecstatic because I've been a Disney freak my whole life. And but I walked into the studio not knowing what to expect, started to record, I started to talk, and I remember Howard Ashman saying, Paige, stop, you don't have to fill the theater here, you know, we want you to be yourself. And like Don said, Paige was Belle. It's the only character in my career where you feel so vulnerable because it is you, you know, Belle is me. I've always had, you know, Edwin Drood or these other characters that are so far different from who I am. But I have to tell you, when it really kind of came together for me was when Robbie Benson and I got to work together. I begged Don Hahn, thank you, Don Hahn, to let Robbie and I record together. And that was not the norm. You're usually by yourself. And Richard White as well. And it made the characters, I think, go to another level, being able to work together. So 3 years of an incredible journey.
Wow, that's amazing. Well, I love Beauty and the Beast too, Sheri. But The Lion King was actually my favorite film growing up. I now watch it with my son Enzo, which is really fun. But Don, can you talk a little bit about making it?
Oh, man. Lion King was a little bit different. It started out with a simple idea from a guy named Charlie Fink, who was the head of our kind of development department. And the idea was this. Let's do Bambi in Africa. And everybody laughed and said, oh, yeah, that's funny. But the idea of doing a coming-of-age story in a place, kind of the breadbasket of humanity, made a lot of sense. And we stumbled through it for a long time. And for a long time, it was called King of the Jungle. Wow. And I couldn't get anybody to work on it because people wanted to work on Pocahontas because people, you know, Alan Menken was doing Pocahontas and Stephen Schwartz. You know, it was like a really interesting project. And my pitch to animators when I would sit down with them at lunch, I would say, I really want you to come work on this movie. It's kind of the Joseph story from the Bible meets Hamlet with music by that African composer Elton John, and it's going to be great. And they would just run from the lunch, leave me with the bill. So it was a challenge. But in the end, we got some amazing people and a great voice cast. And talk about music, you know, we were talking about Alan and Howard, but Tim Rice was our lyricist. Tim, interesting, you may not know this, but his first group he wanted to bring on with ABBA, you know, so you just think, like, what would Lion King be like with that great African-Swedish soundtrack? But they couldn't do it. They were on tour, and Elton came in and tried to be this amazing composer. He hadn't done a Broadway-style musical before, but boy, does that boy have a gift. He is so stunning, and we're just lucky. We're lucky we got him and a great group of artists and a voice cast. As Paige was saying, the voices are so central to developing these characters, and we were lucky to have them all.
So when I was trying to think of favorites that are on Disney Plus, I have too many, but I did keep coming back to one, Don, that you were a central figure of, and Waking Sleeping Beauty. I've always been a fan of all of these stories, but I felt like the behind the story was just as moving. So Don, can you talk a little bit about how the project came about?
This is like therapy. I just want to say this, like someone good money and you're
we'll send you the bill later.
You are so kind. It started out with lunch. Lunch in Pasadena with a guy named Dick Cook, who was running the studio at the time. And we said, you know, it's been 20 years since these movies like Beauty and the Beast had been made, and the great story behind them that no one's really heard. And at the time, he was really open to it and was through the whole project, as was Bob Iger and the executive staff. So the idea was to tell in a truthful way, almost like a jury trial, to say, here's what went on. And what I felt compelled to do was, this is an amazing kind of behind-the-scenes story that I lived through, and I want to put you at the table that I was at, because I was at the table with James Earl Jones and Howard Ashman and Elton John and, you know, all these people. And, you know, I'm just a kid from Southern California. I felt, like, really lucky to be there. So I want to take you on that journey and show you that making art is not easy. And also show you that Disney is not some big corporation. Disney's people like you guys and me, and we're all sitting there struggling to get through our days and find stuff that's entertaining and enjoyable. And I want to show that to you as an audience. That's how it started out. And a lot of it was found footage, and I collected as much as I could. Some of it even from people's garages and from their, you know, videotapes their mothers saved and that kind of stuff. And then I went to you know, the people in the movie, the animators, the executives, and one of my special days there was interviewing Roy Disney. You know, sadly, he wasn't feeling well at that time, but it was the last interview I think he did on tape. And luckily, I have about 2 hours of Roy Disney talking about his life, which someday is a whole other story. But to be sitting in a recording studio at the lot where movies like Peter Pan were recorded with Roy Disney and asking him questions about his life was possibly the highlight of my whole time at Disney. And it makes me well up a little thinking about it, because he was such a great guy and contributed so much to the renaissance of animation at Disney. I just feel glad we were able to capture that story. So that's kind of what was behind the idea of Waking Sleeping Beauty.
You talked about interviewing Roy and how that could be its own movie. Watching it, one thing that I really felt was the Howard Ashman piece felt like, oh my gosh, there was so much here. There's so much story. I was like hoping there was going to be an extra that was as long as Waking Sleeping Beauty. And now, this summer, coming to Disney Plus, we have Howard.
Yeah, you sure do. To be in the room with Howard, and Paige can talk about this too. In fact, the movie starts with June 8th, back in 1989 or 90, recording Belle and Be Our Guest. And the movie starts with Paige. It starts with Paige at the microphone, Howard. And you remember that. It was like unbelievable, because Howard was so supportive, but yet so specific in his direction.
He knew what he wanted. He did.
Yeah, he did. There's no, I don't know. I guess Jeffrey felt the same that you did, that I wanted to take that part of the Waking Sleeping Beauty, but very much the same style of Waking Sleeping Beauty with found objects and bits of storytelling. I wanted to tell that story. And the thing where I was really lucky on that movie is I wanted Howard to tell the story. And I thought, if I get enough audio of Howard talking and lecturing and being on radio and whatever, and I did, we found so much great stuff of him lecturing to the animators and being on New York radio stations when some of his Broadway plays opened, like Little Shop of Horrors and that kind of thing. And so I wanted Howard to just tell us, what, you know, what's it like to be Howard? What are you thinking? And he was so articulate and so learned. I mean, here's a guy with his master's degree in musical theater from Indiana University, and really, you know, track that era. And you know, we can say this now because we're kind of living through a pandemic, sadly, but he was living through an epidemic at the time. And how did he deal with that? How did he deal with tough times and his personal health and things? So it's a story of a very joyful life with a sad ending, tragically. And in the movie, I'd really tried to capture that joy and the fun and the contribution he made to all of our lives. Because, listen, we wouldn't be here in many ways without Howard.
Had Beauty and the Beast and Little Mermaid not happened, with Howard and Alan Menken convincing Disney to let them try to do an animated feature. Look at all these films in the last, since they did that, was 32 years ago as Little Mermaid. I mean, it's mind-boggling.
Yeah. Alan's working on Little Mermaid now, the live-action version of it with Lin-Manuel Miranda. And I just think, wow, can I just come over to your house and watch that? You know, how great would that be?
Me too.
So these movies live on, and you know, partially because of Howard and Alan, partially because of people like Paige and the animators out there. They're great, great stories to tell to begin with, and we were fortunate to be able to tell them.
Yeah, Paige, you worked with Howard on Beauty and the Beast, so what's one thing you remember about him?
He was the most, he had such energy about him. And, I mean, you either went with the ride or you'd get lost in the shuffle. I mean, but if you went for the ride, you'd have a lot of fun, you'd laugh a lot, and you'd learn a lot. And, of course, we all jumped on when he saw something in his mind, and you couldn't help but get excited about it because of his excitement. And ultimately, I think most of the vision of the movie turned out to be what his vision was initially, except for the opening song. That was Alan Menken convincing him. He did not want to have a 7-minute opening song, and Alan convinced him it was perfect. So we won that battle. But it was just so much fun to be around him. You couldn't help but be uplifted by his genius and his incredible energy.
You had a day with Alan when you were singing something there, and Howard and Alan were trying to get a performance up you when you were singing New and a Bit Alarming and that kind of phrase.
And he was actually up in the hospital on the phone directing.
Yeah.
Yes. And he said, that phrase isn't right. And he says, give me a little Streisand. I went, New and a Bit Alarming. You know, it's like, oh, you want an alarming? And then he said, that's it. And that's the last thing I heard of Howard was his voice in my ear saying, that's it, Paige. I was like, oh. You know, you think about this and how important that was, that moment in my life and the history of my life, for sure.
That's a good song. I'm going to cry. Paige, you played Belle in some truly excellent sequels, like The Enchanted Christmas. What's it been like playing Belle over the years and continuing her story?
It's been a blessing, to be honest with you. Who would have thought, you know, that 30 years later, Disney's been a part of my life every day for the past 30 years. Beauty and the Beast, Disney, you know, the last 12 years I'm painting art for Disney Fine Art. But the character and now the perspective of it in my 60s as opposed to my 30s has totally changed. But what's still astounding to me is I'm doing a lot of these meet and greets with my art and with, you know, the celebrations of the movies, you know, 25th and all these. I meet all these people. And I can't tell you how touching it is to hear their stories, how much the movie and how much Belle affected their lives and made an impact on their lives. I can't tell you how many will come and start talking to me and burst into tears when I'm signing autographs and they keep tissue on my table. And it's just so heartwarming. And I just feel like it's such a great gift that Disney gave me to be able to be a part of this and be able to share this amazing film with all these people. And 30 years later, it's as popular now as ever. It really is.
Don, and speaking of Beauty and the Beast still being popular, I was in Orlando in January for the Epcot Festival of the Arts, and I saw the new Beauty and the Beast sing-along in the French Pavilion, where the story of Beauty and the Beast is told from LeFou's perspective, and we learn that he was really responsible for Belle and Beast ending up together. So how did that come about, and how did you get that idea?
Well, I got a phone call from Tom Fitzgerald, Walt Disney Imagineer, this brilliant Imagineer. We've known each other for 30 years. And he said, we'd like to do something for the French Pavilion. There's a brilliant film there that plays, that has been for, you know, since Epcot opened. And we wanted to do something during the day for families so that families could go see it. And he came up with this great idea, the more we talked about it, that maybe there's a twisted fairy tale behind it all. And I think there's a Disney kind of twisted tale series of books and things about what really happened behind the scenes. And the nutty idea we came up with was maybe it's LeFou that was the matchmaker behind it all, because he just ticked off at Gaston for causing all these problems. So I called up Jesse Cordy, And Paige and I worked with Jesse because he was the voice of LeFou. And he's teaching here in Southern California. And I hadn't talked to him in years. And I said, Jesse, we need you to come in for a recording session. And we recorded all this material about him, you know, arranging for them to get together in the snow. And he was making Mel's dress behind the scenes and all the stuff that kind of makes him the matchmaker. And then we were looking for a narrator for the longest time. And we were thinking about a number of different people and whatever. And one day I thought, you know, wouldn't it be great if Angela Lansbury would do this? But, you know, I'm not sure. I don't, she'd want to. And Angela, it's indiscreet to talk about an actress's age, but she is has had a long career, shall we say. And I called her up and she said, oh, I'd love to. And I just about dropped dead. I thought it was amazing. And she showed up. She shows up at the recording studio. She hops in the car and says, oh, hi, everybody. Hi, I was just seeing Downton Abbey. Oh, it's a really good movie. You should all see it. Anyway, I wrote my script. She was so prepared. Talk about pro. And walked in front of the microphone, knew all her lines. We spent just like an hour or two recording everything. And then she said, okay, got to run off. I'm going to go shopping. So she runs out, hops in her car, and goes off. And I just thought that was the best day of my life. I'm having a lot of good days. But she was so fantastic in that. And she's actually right here. I can show you. Mrs. Potts is with me a lot of the time, but here's Mrs. Potts.
Aww.
A special cameo. And Mrs. Potts who narrates that show, and she's always close by wherever I go. But anyway, Mrs. Potts was brilliant. Mrs. Potts, who at one time was called Mrs. Chamomile when we were making the movie, but we thought it was too hard for kids to pronounce chamomile, so we changed her into.
I mean, they can barely pronounce Beauty and the Beast, apparently.
I think that's just you, Sheri. I think that's just you. Paige, you were talking about your art. I actually saw you very briefly at the Festival of the Arts when I was there in January. I was curious, did you have a chance to see the sing-along when you were there?
Oh, yes, I did. We made a little appearance. I sang along with the audience, and Don was texting me. I thought Don was going to be there, and he kept saying, please let me know if people like it. It was like all words. No, you didn't know how people react. Of course, people were screaming and howling and laughing and standing up at the end. It got standing ovation at the end. So
yeah, it's on the internet. I think the day you showed up, somebody filmed it. And it's like the biggest surprise for the audience because the host that day was just saying, you know, we're really happy you're here. This is a brand new show. And to share it with us, here's Belle herself. And Paige comes walking up. I thought people were just going to come unglued. So if you want a treat, you should go hunt that down somewhere. It's just really fun to watch.
And Angela Lansbury, I mean, I could do a whole thing on her. I mean, I idolized her. When I was 17 in New York, I would sneak in at intermission to see her in Gypsy because I couldn't afford to buy a ticket. And they kind of let people do that back then. At intermission, you kind of go in, and I saw her six times as Mama Rose and huge fan. And then got to, when I got to meet her, we had a talk, and I said, your Mama Rose was different than all the other Mama Roses. She said, yes, did you like that? And I said, I loved it. I said, you were the daughter, and Louise was the mom. And she said, why didn't the New York Times get that? It's exactly what I was going for. She was beyond royalty in that. I mean, she's amazing.
Wow. So cool. So we started the show talking about three of our favorite Disney movies, but we want to know what some of your favorites are.
Well, I have to say Mary Poppins. People know this about me. I was a little girl when I saw it, and now it's still my favorite, along with Beauty and the Beast. And my other favorites are Don Hahn movies, okay? So I think, Don Hahn, you're a Disney legend now because I've nominated you this year. You're going to get your Legend Award. I say it's time. I got to see the Howard Ashman documentary, and it is one of the most brilliant films I've ever seen in my life. You're laughing 1 minute, hysterically laughing, gut laughing, and then you're crying your eyes out. It's just all these emotions it takes you through.
Paige, what is it that you, about Don's movies do you think that speaks to you so much? I think we can all agree that they speak to all of us, but I'm curious what it is about them that you love.
He's a great storyteller, you know, and I love the... I love Lion King, but I also love your work with Linda Wolverton. Like, the two of them have the same sense of humor and same kind of view of certain things and people and characters in life. And it's like I said, the Maleficent and Mistress of Evil is just, I think, were two totally brilliant films that should have gotten more acclaim than they did. And I've seen them both a million times now. I'm a geek. I'm now a geek, and I'm a geek of Don Hahn. What can I tell you?
Oh, I'm so sorry. I'll tell you, the secret to Don Hahn, so that you're not too amazed, is if I have a talent, it's not work with great people. You know, I really do. I really, and maybe this was Walt Disney's talent, and I'm no Walt Disney, but I feel like there's something about really interesting artists and people that I love working with. And so if I've had a success in my career, it's because there's such interesting people out there who are storytellers and artists and animators and colorists and all that stuff. And so when I think of these movies I've been lucky to work on, you know, I think of Angelina Jolie and what she brought to Maleficent, and how strong she is as an actress and a director. And people like Brenda Chapman, who were the, you know, she was the head of our story on Lion King and went on to direct Brave, and Linda Wolverton, of course, and just these amazing people who may not be everyday household names, but I promise you they are the ones that are these brilliant kind of contributors to all these movies. So that's the kind of, you know, gift I have, is trying to, there's an old saying about what do producers do. You find the best people you possibly can, and then you do exactly what they tell you to do. I started at Disney 42 or 3 years ago this month, and it's in 1976. I was a child, and I was right out of school, and I worked for people like, I worked for Wooly Reitherman. Well, Wooly Reitherman was one of the 9 old men, and he directed Jungle Book, and he directed 101 Dalmatians. Well, those were two of my favorite movies growing up. Jungle Book was like my favorite. I remember going to the drive-in theater, which for the younger people in the audience was the place where you went to with your car, and you put a speaker in the window, and you got some corn dogs. But I think that particular experience of was really the circle of life for me, because I loved Wooly's movies growing up, and a movie like Jungle Book. And then to be able to show up in his office and work with him and get him coffee and all that stuff, I was really amazed by those guys. And the other thing that was great about that generation of people that worked with Walt Disney, because I never knew Walt Disney or worked with him, is how generous they were. How generous they were to share what they knew, and to look back and look at somebody like me and say, what are you interested in? What do you want to do? And invite me to you know, recording sessions, or help me understand things. And not just me, but all of us. Because I started at the same time as people like Brad Bird and Tim Burton and John Musker and Ron Clements. And our generation really benefited by a very generous generation of people that worked with Walt Disney. And I think that tells you a lot about the culture of Walt and what he created. So, I was, when I look back at Jungle Book, it has a lot of attachments to me. And I really feel like that was a important movement in my life.
People at Disney have always been very generous. Even like the great ones, you think that they wouldn't give you the time of day. Toby Bluth took me under his wing, and
yeah, I feel that way. And I think Paige, you're the same way. It's why we love doing things like this and talking to you guys, because there's probably somebody out there saying, oh man, I think I want to be an artist, but I'm not sure. I want to be an actress or a singer. I'm not sure. And I think that kind of, we felt that way too. We still do. You know, you feel like, how do you start? How do you even begin to make a mark on the world? And the truth is, you just take it one step at a time and one day at a time. And that's why it's so great to talk to you guys and be able to share some of the experiences we've had, because we were very lucky.
Thank you guys for being here.
Well, and hopefully you'll come back and join us for an episode of our audio podcast, which is available on D23.com.
Thanks,
well, thank you both again. And thanks to everyone at home for watching.
And let us know what your Disney Plus throwback favorites are. You can write to us using the hashtag D23 Inside Disney.
And join us for our podcast for Disney news and amazing guests each week at D23 Inside Disney.
Oh, Mrs.
Potts! Oh, Mrs. Potts! Woo!
You want to say goodbye.